So basically, as a quick summary of what we're starting to look at, the basics of the soil and link that to nutrient uptake. Obviously, they, often they can be looked at quite independently. Soil tests can actually be looked at as absolute individual figures, where you really need to start looking at that correlation chemistry that starts linking those all those figures together. The basics of the plant nutrients and importance. There's essentially six essential nutrients for to grow a plant, so 16 Lego blocks. That's all you've got to deal with, just the different volumes of them. Some of them the soil's already providing for you, others you've got to tie in how we best time their applications to get them into the system. Water use efficiency, which you've all heard about, millimetres of rain to tonnes per grain, and then link that back to soil use efficiency. And often when we get these water use efficiency figures, not really given a platform to move forward and work out how we actually improve our water use efficiency. We can't just always just base it on rain, because 9 times out of 10 we're getting less rain rather than more, unless you live in Cummins. And then making sense of your data. There's a lot of data starting to fly around. More soil tests we do, we're starting to look at more figures, but how do we start making sense of that and actually making sure any data we collect is actually being utilised on our, in our farm production, rather than a whole lot of numbers that turn into maps that look good that we actually haven't used, or like many people deal with the yield monitors, trapping all this information and no one's taken the card out of the machine for like 10 years. So trying to work out, there is a lot of value captured in that, which Richard will start tying into later on as well, when we actually start getting value out of these maps. So setting up a bit of a platform to say, right, what information do we need to start moving forward? So I'll run through some basics on soil just to get you sort of primed with the approach that we're coming from. So you've got to basically look at soil as your battery. So it runs on all positive and negative charges, it's your energy system. And that's the soil's not just a medium to hold a plant up in, it is the whole system that makes the whole plant fire. So you've got basically, soil is a net negative charge, you hear that thrown around. So overall it's got more negative charge sites than it does positive. So it does still retain positive and negative nutrients. And within a soil test, probably needs to be outlined a bit more, but within that soil test, you'll be testing positive charge nutrients such as your cations, your calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and then you've got negatively charged nutrients such as your nitrate, sulfate, boron. All these things are negatively charged, and that's why they leach through. It's not just that they're mobile, there's a reason why they're mobile, because negative doesn't like attracting to negative. Negative needs a positive to retain it there. So yeah, big thing to start being aware of, because once you understand how your nutrients are charged, either positive or negative, and then you look at your cation exchange capacity, which is the overall size of your bank account's capacity to hold your money, which is your nutrient. So starting getting that linkage point is then you can start working out, well, why do I need this nutrient early, or why do I need it late, or why might, yeah, if water's limiting, what's going to be the first limiting nutrient? So it all comes back to your battery. So if you think, right, how much charge is in my Duracell bunny, then that's what we've got to operate on in the season. So critical point is that, yeah, soil has a net negative charge and relies on those positively charged nutrients attracting to that, and then you've also got the positive charge sites that let your negatives attach. More, it's, yeah, quite a simple process, but if you can think just battery, different terminals on your soil, and a clay soil has a lot more negatively charged sites than, say, a sand. So that's why organic matter as well has a lot of negative charge sites as well. So that's where the benefit of organic matter comes into. So yeah, soil is your battery. Still staying on that charge theme is thinking like nutrients are retained to those battery terminals like a magnet. So cation exchange capacity, you look at your face of your soil particles. That's where most of your charge is to hold onto those nutrients, and that provides your full bank account. When you look at your soil test, you'll see 3,000 parts per million of calcium. It doesn't mean all that calcium's there ready for the plant to take up now. It's what, when we test it, or the lab tests it, it's what they think the plant can get over a season. They've got access to this big bank account. But what the plant actually accesses is what's in soil solution. So what's weakly held is readily available for plant uptake. So over the season, moisture is the carrier for your nutrients. Starts taking these nutrients off the exchange sites, and it comes into equilibrium in solution. So of that 3,000 parts per million of calcium in your soil, you might only have 10 parts per million actually in solution. So you've got a huge bank account, but your actual wallet of nutrients is actually quite low. So you've got $100,000 in the bank, but you've only got about 10 bucks in your wallet. So even though you've got a big reserve of money, you can only buy a pie, an iced coffee and a Mars bar for lunch, and that's your $10 gone. And that's what the plant's tapping into. And that's fully reliant on moisture content in the soil. So critical factor, moisture is the mover of nutrients, and you've got to have moisture for that uptake of nutrients. So then within that, we've then got to find those linkage points between how of that soil test we take, how much are those plants tapping into now? Because quite often you think, geez, there's a hell of a lot of these nutrients in the soil, but you can still start running what looks to be deficiencies. And it's getting that linkage point in soils between what is a deficiency and what is an inefficiency. Because there are two key components, and some of it can be moisture limiting, others can be just a direct competition. And as soon as you have something high in your soil, don't think, oh, that's great, that's high in my soil, don't have to worry about it. Start thinking, right, if that's really high, how is that offsetting something else? Because if something's really high, it's going to be stopping the uptake of one of the other nutrients. So it's always getting those linkage points, and then we'll come to how they're then taken up into the plant. So I'm saying you've got 16 elements, essential elements that basically grow a plant, and you have a whole string of nutrients on a soil test, as many of you have seen. It's just making sense of that data. And the best thing to do is to start compartmentalizing them into sections to say, right, how's this operating for me? So something like nutrients, think of nutrients, these are the main heavy hitters to actually grow a plant. So nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, sulfur, they're the big main users in a plant. When you start looking at especially nitrogen, phosphorus and sulfur, you've actually got very little to do with actually that how that soil holds together. A lot to do with how the microbes all take off and then actually growing a plant. But they're very much focused on plant growth rather than soil function. Then you start looking at your electrolytes. So your calcium, magnesium, potassium is the K and sodium is the Na. So they're your electrolytes. So they're like your Gatorade in your soil system. So like I was saying, they'll hold on to your exchange sites, like the strong end of the magnet, they'll hold in big reserves there, but then also they effectively dilute out and come into the soil solution in an equilibrium out there, and that's what's readily plant available. So electrolytes, those calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium are hugely important in how a soil holds together. Like you've got high magnesium soils and you'll come out with platform shoes, you've got high potassium, sodium soils where you're driving to the paddock and your wheels start slipping in about 2 seconds, and then you've got high calcium soils, which you know all about, with basically like road base, and you get the limestone soils eventuating from that. So they have a huge component, a huge structural side of things in the soil function, but then are also critical plant nutrients. So whenever you're applying them or trying to work out how much of those nutrients I need, you've got to work out, right, how much is the soil going to be accounting for this? And the soil doesn't want to necessarily let up all those nutrients. And then how much of those nutrients is going to be available for plant uptake? So that's a critical component. Micronutrients, manganese at the top, zinc, copper, boron, moly, cobalt, there's a whole string of them that are essential for the plant function. And you've got to think of them as your catalysts in the system. So they're your firing pins that make these nutrients work to greater efficiency. If you don't have those catalysts down the end, the amount of nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur you have to chew up to get your sort of proteins being built, all your sugars being built, all that to start happening is a hell of a lot higher. So you're chewing up energy just trying to do day-to-day processes because you've got the little gap fillers, the firing pins, the catalysts, those trace elements are critical for tying that all together. So if they're limiting in a system, you can find those efficiencies being dropped out. And often people will be put out the micronutrients and not get a response, and that's where you've got to be really key on looking at different forms you'll have that you can buy at different shops, different brands, have different effectivenesses. Some are better in acidic soils, some are better in alkaline soils, some are great as foliars, some aren't as great as foliars. So that's a critical thing to start looking out for. You're saying, if it's showing up low in a soil test, there's a reason for it. You've got to work out, right, how do we start addressing that for plant availability? And if it's low in a soil test and you're not getting a plant response, you've got to start thinking, right, am I using the right form? Rather than saying, this isn't a zinc responsive soil, this isn't a manganese responsive soil. It's one of those critical things to start linking together. And often when you do trials at home, you'll find, oh, I'll just put in one nutrient extra. So you might go and just put in manganese as a trial and say, right, do I get a response from that? But if you know Liebig's law of the minimum, like the leaky bucket, where the lowest point you grow as far as your most limiting point in the bucket, if you go and put out manganese, but your zinc's still deficient, you're only going to be still going as far as your zinc, so your manganese can be wasted if it's already higher than your zinc. So little things like that you've got to be aware of, that you don't throw out nutrients before you've actually properly validated the response you're chasing. That's then all linked it into carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. Some of that's coming from the environment, sunlight, water, air, all that. Ties all that together. Carbon, hydrogen, oxygen also are the building blocks of carbohydrates. Carbohydrates built to starches, fills grain, all of that. We then tie it to soil use efficiency. So how many litres of soil are your roots using in the soil, in your soil profile? Some profiles are limited, as you're probably aware, like shallow topsoils, deep calcareous subsoils. You've got less topsoil to deal with than others that have a huge 1.5 metre depth of soil, but they still only use that top 10 centimetres. You say, right, why is that happening and how do we start understanding those nuts and bolts between that? Because once you get that soil use efficiency worked out, you then get that water use efficiency, which leads to plant performance. We're all chasing yield here. That's what we're trying to get out of it. And how do we get that? It's just understand the full linkage between what we're putting in and what we're getting out. And it's all been driven by the soil. So yeah, that soil use efficiency concept, like I was going into, yes, I know some soils do have a bit of a barrier at, say, that 15-centimetre mark, but too often we see, we're at home in soil pits, so see it a lot of the time where your concentration of nutrients and roots sit up in your top 0 to 15, 0 to 20, and then you've got a full bucket of plant available nutrients by a soil test, but for whatever reason they're not plant accessible. So on a soil test, when you start pulling them out at different depths, sink down a core, pull it out, test at different depths, you can actually miss impasses that are there. It's actually been aware of working out what is plant available on a soil test and link it back to plant accessible. There might be some impasse down at 30 centimetres, it might be chemical, it might be physical toxicity, like physical compaction, say, or a chemical toxicity. So linking that together, understanding what could be happening at depth to stop this root distribution, root architecture developing, and how can we start swaying it towards what's on the right-hand side, we get a bigger depth of root system and start tapping into nutrients down the profile. Which then ties back into that soil testing is so critical. Because too often you walk across a paddock, sink in a probe, down to whatever it be, 0 to 10, 0 to 15, not really caring necessarily what depth you're going to, just saying, I'm getting a topsoil sample. Too often you'll see that you'll start crossing layers. And when you start crossing layers within a soil, yes, this is a sort of showing 0 to 25 centimetres, but you can have these happening at 0 to 8 centimetres when you start hitting that next layer. And what you've got to realise is, we'll talk about, you talk to farmers around, say, oh, from that range or from this town, you're dropping inch of rain per mile. Similar thing with nutrients. You can have a high concentration sitting in this topsoil, and then you start dropping off quite quickly of your nutrients, and then it can be getting higher in other nutrients that you wouldn't even know, leading to toxic values that are sitting down at depth. So being aware of these soils to these nutrients to different layers is critical. And then actually understanding what you're testing. Because suddenly if you go into this range here, you say 440 parts per million of potassium around here, and you're going down into a region of 160, you're just averaging out the 440 and 160 and coming around the 200 mark, when actually you've got quite a high value up here and low down here. So you want to know these extremes, especially when you start going to precision ag and trying to get that value out of soils for that precision ag. You're saying, right, we've got to be staying, be more precise with our soil testing and understanding our soils to horizon within a profile. Because as soon as you start linking these soil tests back to soil moisture probes, many of you might have, or have district ones you start linking it back to, this becomes critical. If you're wetting up from the top down, or you've had early rains and then start drawing from nutrients from below up, these two soil tests can be markedly different. So if you're relying on 0 to 10 moisture, you've got lots of shallow, like wetting rains that wet the 0 to 10 quite often, you're running on most of your 0 to 10 nutrient test, so nutrient analysis. But if you have those early rains, get good root growth, and 90% of your roots are really tapping, and your moisture and roots are sitting down at 25 centimetres plus. There aren't too many people who have started testing down at that depth for your full range of nutrients. People start doing deep ends and stuff, but you actually find that they actually are drawing on 90% of their whole nutrient package out of this subsoil, which is why you some seasons you think, I'll hate off a hell of a lot quicker than other years, even though with the same amount of moisture in the profile, it's just a matter of where it's sitting, because you might have lower potassium down at depth, higher in the topsoil, so when you're drawing on your subsoil, no potassium there, so you're just haying off in about 2 seconds flat, as opposed to when you had high potassium in your topsoil, had plenty of moisture up there, had potassium coming in, and you're not going to be so stressed. So little things like that where your potassium regulates your water loss in a plant. So it's a critical factor is linking those soil test nutrients to your plants. And then you start linking it back to how they're taken up. So quite simply, plants take up nutrients in three ways. Mass flow, so as plants move water out the top of the plant, transpires through the plant, it sucks in water and with that come nutrients, which is like we're saying about that source is so critical, where you're on that weak side of the magnet, where you're further away from the magnet, what's coming in solution just keeps coming in through mass flow. With that, say it comes 80% of your calcium, magnesium. So if you've got overcast days or low sunlight, low transpiration weather, you start getting lower uptake of some of these nutrients and nitrogen as well. Something like diffusion, which is purely going from a high concentration to a low concentration. So from, say, a fertilizer granule is high concentration, then it'll move out from there to your root surface, so which is the lowest concentration. So then you start seeing your potassium moving in. 80% of your potassium just keeps diffusing in. So as long as you've got moisture in your soil, your potassium will still keep diffusing through. And then something like root interception, where you're reliant on root architecture. So the amount of roots, root surface area, something like phosphate needs that root surface area because it's only going to move about 0.5 centimeter per year. So you need those roots to start growing to it, then it'll diffuse into the plant. So when you start going around pulling up plants, and you'll see coming out of winter, you're pulling up a plant, and then you suddenly see this hole in the 0 to 10, just those roots just taking off. You get a whole lot of little white tips, and you think, oh, why am I pulling up these roots? It's actually to start looking at that root architecture, because if you're getting a heap of those fine little roots taking off, it means your plants have started, your soil temperature's warmed up to sort of 12 or so degrees, your phosphate's starting to come back into the system, and your roots just take off. And that's just to get surface area to volume ratio to get phosphate. It's getting that linkage point, say, right, what are my roots telling me about what my plant's actually taking up? Something like calcium as well. If you've got old roots, plants take up calcium from that root tip, so they keep on needing new root tips to start taking up calcium. So that calcium phosphate linkage is critical. And all this relies on, so how you get nutrients into a plant is primarily by moisture, to rely on that mass flow uptake of nutrients, and plants need moisture to be able to, nutrients need moisture to diffuse through the soil to the plants so that plants can then take them up. And then root interception needs moisture, obviously, and as well as porosity. So as long as you have pores in the ground, you'll get root development. A plant can't, if you don't have the pores there, which are the voids, the holes in the soil, can be microscopic or quite large, roots will go through them and then make those pores bigger. If there's no pores there to start with, the roots aren't going to go through. Everyone thinks canola is going to punch down through a soil and whatever. There's no pores there for it to start with, and it's going to J-root across till it finds somewhere and then go down till it finds those pores. So yeah, don't think you're going to put a canola in and say, I'm going to punch through this hard pan. You've got to actually still have that porosity there, which then comes back to being critical about then what implement choice you're going to use, disc versus tine. And the soil doesn't lie. The soil will tell you there in front of you. And the amount of porosity, it's all given back to that soil structure, which is all linked together by those that electrolyte function in your soil, that calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium. Where they sit, you can basically start looking at a soil test and say, right, I think you're probably going to need, and a photo of your soil pit or of your soil, you'll say, no, you're better off running a tine in that soil. You can get away with running a disc in that soil. You might get some good seed placement with a disc in this soil, but you're going to suffer on your germination. In your country, you need good early root growth. All that can be linked back to a image of your soil, your 0 to 10 basically of your soil profile, and 0 to 20, and then link it to your soil test as well. So only that makes those decisions of, do I invest in 150 grand into this bar, a whole lot more real. This is called the Cooney chart, because when Mark first started working with us, we're saying, well, how do we start explaining this linkage point to say, in different soil types, this is obviously going to change, but nitrogen and phosphorus, huge cost input, but big bang for your buck. And then something like micronutrients can be very low cost in certain situations, but get a huge response, because like I was saying, they're your efficiency that drives your nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, sulfur. So critical component to see where they link in to what drives your system forward. So like I say, this is going to change if you're in a sand or a heavier clay or a sand over clay. It all changes around, like I was saying, but it's a critical point to just have in your mind and say, hey, on, what is my missing point? Can I put a small cost in to actually get a big result back. Different soils, different pH, and pH is a key thing. You see those, everyone measures pH, pH in water, pH in calcium chloride. Oh, it's just a different figure. Actually means quite a lot. How much reserve acidity, how much you got buffering, so if you're gonna put lime out or not. All these things are so critical. When you start looking at pH, it's your driver to what nutrient availability is. Many soils, I was saying that 0 to 10, 10 to 20 soil test, you often see 5.5, 6 pH soil in your top soil, sitting over about 8.5 pH in your next band below. And that, so 0 to 10, 5.5, then 10 to 20 is suddenly up around 8, 8.5. When you go from 5 to 6, that's 10 times more alkaline. When you go 5 to 7, that's 10 times 10. That's 100 times more alkaline. When you go 5.5 to say 8.5, that's 10 times 10 times 10. That's 1,000 times more alkaline when you go down. So your plant roots going from in a nice 0 to 10, well, slightly acidic, 0 to 10, then it's going bang into this high pH next layer. And the whole nutrient availability has changed. So if your moisture's sitting in that 10 to 20 centimeters, it's trying to tap nutrients out of that, compared to when you're 0 to 10, where it's got greater accessibility, especially of micronutrients. So key thing, $15 test from Bunnings, that little powder puffer test is a big thing to start actually saying, right, what are my plant extremes and my plant running into? And then being aware of what ameliorants you're putting out, so what soil conditions you're putting out is gonna be key to how you start managing it and what response you're trying to get. So liming, a lot of people think it's like a calcium response, but the calcium carbonate, so that's a carbonate response. So it's like when you did the volcano at school for your kids or whatever, you put the vinegar with the bicarb soda, you get that fizzing reaction. Same sort of things when you're putting lime out on acid soil, that carbonate reacts with your acidity in your soil and effectively releases CO2 and then cancels out your acidity. Then something like gypsum, so calcium and lime and gypsum are actually relatively insoluble. So calcium carbonate, lime is 0.01 grams per litre, which is why it works over a number of years, because you need the litres of water to get it to solubilise to come into the system. Something like gypsum is about 2.6 grams per litre. So for every litre of water that hits those tonnes you put out, you're only getting 2.6 grams for each unit of that. So being aware of that, which is why they're long-term effects, which is why sometimes you're better off going out with say 2 tons rather than hitting it with 5 tons, because you're actually going to release something over a long period of time. So just being aware of your rates and how they're actually working for is a critical thing. Non-wetting soils, just want to touch on this. You've got different non-wetting layers in the soil, and how we understand it's a critical thing to understand. When you're ripping through a 0 to 10, you can actually be dropping that sand in behind the tine and actually making your whole seed bed completely non-wetting. You think you're trying to open it up, but you've actually just dropped sand down in there. Non-wetting is just wax coating sand particles. So it's like when you have chops for dinner and then you go and try and wash your plate and all the water washes off, and it won't actually, can't clean your plate. Then you drop a bit of detergent on there and it all just breaks down. You can wash your plate quite easily. Same thing with non-wetting soils, is that's very similar wax component to it, which is where the use of wetters have been. Wetters have been great in some areas, but there are a whole lot of different forms of them as well. But from us, we've found that the in-furrow approach to those plant near the seed, at least when you've got a wetter near the seed, it starts drawing water towards that. And then banded on top has also been a strategy. Clay spreading, delving, spading, get some huge results out of that. But can't heed nothing more than just being aware of what clay you're putting out. So when you go and do a test, even if you just test the pH, you'll see some show up really high pH, and you go and spread it, and snails all take off just due to the high carbonate in those soils. Then you can go to some other, the clay looks exactly the same, but then performs beautifully, still disperses nicely and gets that good even coverage and has a great response. So being aware of that clay is critical, and I can't stress anything more than get that clay tested. For a couple hundred bucks to get your clay tested, you can save a hell of a lot of heartache of managing snails into the future. Building on from what Kelly was saying and tying it all together, your standard soil testing, what you've all got is your bank account of nutrients. So there was potentially available, then you can start looking at what's going to be in your wallet. So we're starting to look at these water soluble analysis to say, right, how readily is this bank account coming into our wallet? So key thing to look for. And then like Kelly said, you start with precision soil technology, and linking into precision ag is getting these spots GPS'd, understand that soil intimately to 0 to 10, like your first horizon, and wherever your second horizon is, and even your third. And then if you've got moisture probes as well, start linking your moisture back to your nutrients in your profile, and then actually where your roots are sitting. Because once you start linking those together, you're a very powerful tool to actually predict what's going to happen for the season, and whether you do need to go out with potassium this year, or do need to go out with extra nitrogen. Do I have enough sugars keeping up with it in my plant? None of this information is new. Something like this, Mulder's chart, 1950s, it's just looking at this soil antagonisms and interrelationships of nutrients within the soil. You've got a stimulus and antagonism of nutrients. You put some nutrients on and can actually get a response out of, it's actually releasing other nutrients out of your soil bank account. So that's a key thing to understand. When you're putting something on, you are getting other reactions that are actually going to carry in with those nutrients. It's like when you put urea out, mineralizes in the soil, and it actually starts bringing in other nutrients as well. It's not just a nitrogen response. So Mulder's chart, 1950s, it's a great thing to have up on the wall and start thinking about, right, I've got going to my high potassium country, how's that going to affect my nitrogen, calcium, magnesium, and then going to my calcareous country, high calcium, how's that going to affect my magnesium, potassium, nitrogen, phosphorus, all that. Simple linkages. And then linking back to plant tissue testing. Plant tissue testing is often getting thrown out, or saying, oh, it doesn't link to my soil test, so I'll just plant tissue test, or vice versa, I'll just soil test. It is a point in time. A plant tissue test is, yes, an assessment of a current nutrient status. When it's calibrated to growth stage and time of season, it can be quite powerful. But you've got to be careful not to take those numbers in absolutes. Plant tissue tests can look like a really healthy plant, but it's nearly dead because it's grown to a short height and accumulated nutrients to a high density in a small plant and tests up beautifully. A really vigorous growing plant has a lot of diluted nutrients. So you can actually eat, like, yes, dilute effectively what show up in a test. So always calibrate to what you've seen in the field and benchmark it to that. And then in correlation with a soil test, you can see, like I'm saying, where those nutrients sit within a soil profile. You can see, why have I got high magnesium in my plant this year, or low potassium, when it looks completely different to what it was last year. It can be just where it's dragging those nutrients from in that soil profile. So key points for this soil and plant management is soil test, and soil test accurately. Once you've got that, those maps, yield maps, whatever maps it is, you've got a template that essentially reflects that variability. It's great to then be able to ground truth that. When something's high yielding, high protein, why is that? Why is it low yielding, high protein, low yielding, low protein? It's all back to nutrient linkage and water as your currency to move those nutrients. Link that back to your nutrient management program. Some soils you just know you're not going to get enough of a certain nutrient up front, so you've got to manage that mid-season. Others, you know, you can get your full quota up front and it's going to be available for the whole season. So your soil test is going to tell you that. It's not just a guessing game. Plant tissue test, once you've got all this information, you get a lot more clarity out of your plant tissue test. They suddenly make a lot more sense. And then with that information, you can then, with great confidence, start enhancing your nutrient levels. It's not just, many times you get the phone call saying, oh, if I put this out, will I get a response? It's like, no, you will get a response because you know X, Y, Z factors are compounding against you. So that's just your weakest link that's going to kick you forward. Sort of starting to summarize, what more can we look at? Critically, understanding that soil to each horizon, each layer within that profile to that site. Then you start understanding your nutrient distribution through your profile. Is it high in the 0 to 10, low in the 10 to 20? And that causes these different stresses, especially when you start linking that to moisture distribution. Are there toxicities sitting down where your moisture is, and that's where your plants are drinking from, so they get an exacerbated stress. And then understanding your management strategies, like I was saying, soil or foliar. And sometimes once you start understanding your soil and the tests you do on them, you say, yep, you're full confidence you can go in up front with that, or no, you need to go half and half, or two-thirds, one-third, and start splitting your applications like that. But hopefully this gives you a bit of a snapshot. Michael's going to build onto this later on when we start looking at the in-furrow science behind that, about how we can manage that going forward. But yeah, thank you for your time, and hopefully that's sparked a bit of interest. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. Look, we've got time for a few questions, so if anyone's got any questions, fire away.
Recalibrating your your parameters for different nutrients and so on. So if you're suggesting you go into a plant, into a crop that looks visually good, and you do, and you get back a leaf test, how would you interpret that data then?
Well, for me, I'd want to see the soil test, and I'd like to see certain soils, you have them showing up, say, low in boron, and the plant tissue test shows very low boron, but you know it's about to run into it in about a week's time when it hits that next layer. But you often see sort of recommendations come back and say, no, you need to put boron out, but then it's been aware that you're going to run into that. So linking that soil profile to your plant nutrient level is a key thing. Also, certain points in time, if you know, if magnesium, say, accumulating in a plant actually can be deficient. There's a whole lot of research about where those nutrients sit in a plant to then why they aren't, where they're going to tail off, and they can actually be running a deficient level. So critical to get that soil test and say, right, if it's high in the soil but low in the plant, why is that? Is it just a moisture factor? Or if it's low in the soil but high in the plant, you're like, right, is my plant hyper-accumulating it and then storing it, and then it's going to run out of it by the time it's the mid to late season? So, we can talk about, there's a whole lot of different things you can start looking for within that, but it's just, it is season dependent and soil type dependent for sure, what those things you're looking for.
So an example there was that magnesium, as you see, in the soil you've got limited magnesium, but you'll see it in the plants, so it's hyper accumulated, as Ed said, but you look at what's in the soil solution and what's sitting on the exchange site to help both clay and organic matter, and then you'll know in this season it won't have enough magnesium, which is leaf greenness, chlorophyll. So when you put your nitrogen out, you won't have enough magnesium to make that leaf green, to suck in sunlight to make grain. So sometimes if people look at a tissue and say, I've got enough magnesium, we know that you haven't, to go right through. So it's just looking at the life cycle of the crop. But it sounds complex, it's not that complex. It's just, once you understand it fairly quickly, you know as farmers how to look at that.
Any further questions, Rick? Thanks, Ed. Thanks for that one. Like we said, guys, we've got a bit of time at the end. We can throw everyone back up front and handle any questions that might not have been covered at that point. I'd like to now introduce Richard May from Cummins Ag Service.